everyone, welcome to GemChem. Now today's video is on covalent bonding, and here we are going to deal with hybridization, energetics of hybridization. Now before starting, already two videos of covalent bonding are uploaded in channel. You can watch it. I will give the link in the description box as well as the I button present above this video. And if you are new to GemChem, do not forget to subscribe the channel and hit the bell icon for regular updates. Now let us start. So what is hybridization? Now the basic meaning of hybridization is the combination of two or three variants, right? So here only in chemistry, hybridization refers to basically the mixture of orbitals, atomic orbitals in specific. Now here we are going to deal with qualitative thing, and for details you can refer to the organic video. I will give the link in the description box as well as the I button for this particular video, right? Now hybridization is a theoretical model to explain bonding of molecules where atomic orbitals of a particular atom having similar symmetry and energy undergo mixing to form equal number of mixed orbitals or hybrid orbitals, and these orbitals are so oriented in space that they can overlap with suitable orbitals of the substituents. So it means that if you have, suppose, one s orbital and one p orbital, they will combine together to give you two sp hybridized orbitals, right? Now if we want to see what is hybridization, we will take the example of CH4. And from the previous video we have seen that from VSEPR's theory we can predict the structure, which is tetrahedral. But what about the orbitals? How these orbitals are involved in forming the tetrahedral structure? So if we want to start drawing, then we know that the configuration of carbon is 1s2, 2s2 and 2p2. Now for hybridization of tetrahedral structure, we require sp3 hybridization. That is, there is involvement of 1s orbital plus 3p orbitals, px, py and pz, right? And here if you can see, the configuration shows that two electrons are present in 2s, whereas two electrons are present in 2p. So we require another electron to be present in 2p. So one of the electrons from here jumps to the 2p, and this is our excited state. That is, here is one electron and the other electrons are here, 1, 2, 3. And this forms our hybridized orbital, which is sp3, which is sp3, and ultimately we get four sp3 hybridized orbitals which have one electron each, right? And these hybrid orbitals makes a sigma bond with hydrogens which are four in number, right? And this is what actually happens here. So this is important, and how hybridization occurs is also important. Question comes to show the hybridization and the structure determination. So this is how it occurs. Now if you try to draw the diagram, then in this case it will be like this. That is, here is the tetrahedral structure which we have seen in our previous video, and these are the shades, and we have three axes. That is, 1, 2, and another comes from here, goes about here, and the orbital for the central atom, that is carbon, is like this, and like this. And the sigma orbitals of hydrogen are like this, here, and another present here. So this is how bonding occurs in tetrahedral. And it looks like this permanently. That is, this one here, one here, one here, and hydrogens present here gets bonded like this. So this is the total concept of hybridization. Now if these hybrid orbitals are of equal energy, it is a case of equivalent hybridization, and if they are of different energies, then they are non-equivalent hybridization. And in this video we will deal with only equivalent hybridization. So if you see here, For linear structure, we have SP, SD and PD hybridization. For planar trigonal, we have sp2 hybridized orbital for the central atom. For tetrahedral, we have sp3 and sd3. For trigonal bipyramidal, we have sp3d and dsp3. For octahedral, we are having sp3d2 and d2sp3. And for pentagonal bipyramidal, we are having sp3d3 and d3sp3. Right, for this case, if you see, that is for this sp3d2, we can have like this 3s, 3p, 3d. Right, and if we have dsp2, then we can have like this 3d, 4s, 4p. This is how the pattern goes. Right, now we will deal with few structures. So, first thing which we will see is for POCl3. Now, let us first count the electrons. For this, we have 5 electrons from phosphorus plus 1 minus 1, that is for sigma and pi of oxygen. And next we have plus 3 for 3 chlorines and we get ultimately 8. That is, it has a tetrahedral structure. Now, if we draw it, it will look like this. P double bond O, Cl, Cl, Cl. Now, we need to know what is the hybridization of this particular atom. Right. Now, see, phosphorus has a configuration of neon, 3s2, 3p3. And if we draw it like this, that is neon, and here our 3s with 2 electrons, 3p with 3 electrons, then there is a hybridization occurring. So here one of the electrons will jump into the next orbital, that is, which is 3d, right? So one of the electron will come here. Ultimately, what we are going to get is from the next step is that this kind of moiety, that is, here is one, here is our 3 electrons in the p orbital, and the d orbital is carrying 1 electron in the excited state. Right, here is one of the electrons present and this is our excited state. Ultimately, there is a hybridization to form sp3 hybridized orbital, and here this will bond a sigma bond with chlorine, this will form a sigma bond with chlorine, this one also sigma bond with chlorine, and another will form a pi and sigma bond with oxygen. Now, this pi bond is formed basically due to the d orbital's electron. This one gives the pi bonding with the oxygen, right? So, this is how it forms, and this hybridization is sp3. Here is p pi and here is d pi bonding for the pi ones, right? Now, we will see for the next structure, which is SO2. Now we will see for the next structure, which is SO2, right? So let us start counting. So if you see here, it is 6 plus 2, 1 minus 1, which is equals to 6. So we have a structure which is like this, that is S with a lone pair, double bond oxygen, double bond oxygen. Now we have to know the hybridization of this sulfur. Now what is the configuration of sulfur? Let us write. Sulfur gives us neon, 3s2, 3p4. And if we start drawing, then it is like this, 3s, and here are 2 electrons in 1, then 1, 1. Now this is the ground state, but we require in each orbital only 1 electron. So we will see that it comes like this. 1 electron from the p orbital goes to the 3d orbital. So here is 2, here is 1, 2, then 1, 1, 1, and the 1 from here, this one goes to the d orbitals. So here is 1. So what happens ultimately is that there is sp2 hybridization, that is, this forms a hybridization here up to this. There is two hybridization, sp2 hybridization, right? And this one forms 1p, that is, one lone pair is being formed by using this electron, one sigma bond is formed by oxygen, sigma bond by another oxygen, this forms the pi bond with oxygen, and this also forms the pi bond with oxygen. Now it is satisfied, right? So sp2 hybridization, and the pi bond is being formed by this one p pi bond, another is p pi d pi bond. Here d electron is involved, and here p electron is involved, right? Now we will go for the next one, that is NO2 plus, and we know from the electron count, that is 5 plus 2, 1 minus 1, minus 1 equals to 4. It has a linear structure and it looks like somewhat like this. O-N-O. Now, what is the hybridization of sulfur we need to know? What is the hybridization of nitrogen we need to know, right? So, nitrogen has a configuration of helium, 2s2, 2p3. Now N plus has a configuration of helium, 2s2, 2p2. Now if we start drawing the configuration, 2s and 2p, two electrons, one electron, one electron, this is the ground state. Now this electron, as we have seen, this electron will jump into this orbital. So ultimately our configuration will be like this. Here three electrons distributed. Now if we try to see it, this will be hybridized, sp hybridization, right? And this will form a pi bond with oxygen, this will form a pi bond with oxygen, and this will form a sigma bond with oxygen, and this one will also form a sigma bond with oxygen. So it has sp hybridization. And the pi bond is formed by p pi of nitrogen and p pi of oxygen in this case, right? Now we will deal with SnCl2-. So for SnCl2-, we need to consider the central atom. So we are taking central atom as sulfur. So 6 plus 1 minus 2 plus 2 plus 1 equals to 8. And it is tetrahedral. So let us draw it. So it will be like this: sulfur, lone pair, chlorine, chlorine, and a triple bond with nitrogen. And this has a negative charge. Now see here, what will be the hybridization of this, right? So let us write the configuration of sulfur first. Sulfur is neon, 3s2, 3p4. And sulfur minus is neon, 3s2, 3p5. And if we draw the configuration right here, then this, that is, here 3s orbital, here there is p orbital, and we have a d orbital, right? And first the configuration will be like this, that is, here is two electrons, here is 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. And in the next step, these one electron from here and one electron from here will jump here. So here is one, here is one. Now here we are left with one electrons each, and ultimately we will get the hybridization to be as sp3, and this will form lone pair. This will form a sigma bond with chlorine. This will form a sigma bond with chlorine. This will form a sigma bond with nitrogen. And in this case, this will form a pi bond with nitrogen. And this one will form a pi bond with nitrogen. Right. Now we are going to see for HCO2F2. Now in the previous videos we have already seen the structure, right? So it has a 8 plus 2, 1 minus 1 plus 2 equals to 10. That is TBP structure, right? And the hybridization must be sp3d. So it looks like this, with two oxygens present here, fluorines up. And we are now going to sketch out the hybridization pattern. So HC have configuration of 5s2 in the valence shells and 5p6. And if we try to draw it, it will be like this, and this will be filled, right? So this will be filled, and so we have to just consider the valence orbitals present after these. So if we consider the valence orbitals present after these, so the electrons will jump. So here we are left with only 3 electrons, and the other 3 electrons will go into the 5d orbitals. 1, 2, 3. Now there is a hybridization taking place, which is sp3d. So sp, 3 p's and then d. So sp3d hybridization. And to focus more, this will form lone pair, this will form sigma bond with oxygen, this will form a sigma bond with oxygen, and this will form a sigma bond with fluorine. This will also form a sigma bond with fluorine, whereas these electrons will form pi bond with oxygen, and this will also form pi bond with oxygen, right? Now we will deal with NO2 plus and NO2 and NO2 minus. So first of all, NO2 plus, we have already seen it is sp hybridized. It is sp hybridized, sp being linear, and this one should be 5 plus 2, 1 minus 1 plus 1 equals to 6. So it should look like somewhat like this, with a lone pair, double bond here, oxygen O minus, and the hybridization should be sp2, 120 degree sp2. And if you see here, for this, we have 5 plus 2, 1 minus 1 equals to 5. And this is an odd electron molecule. And its structure will be somewhere between NO2 minus and NO2 plus. So it is written as like this. O minus, double bond oxygen. And here we have a positive sign. Here we have a dot. And this is SPN hybridized. That is, it is 1 greater than N, this one. That is, the N hybridization lies between the SP2 and SP hybridization. Now we will see for ClO2 plus, ClO2 and ClO2 minus. So right now, if we try to write the configuration and the drawings, so 7 plus 2, 1 minus 1, minus 1 equals 6. For this one, we have 7 plus 2, 1 minus 1 equals 7. Next is 7 plus 2, 1 minus 1 plus 1 equals 8. And if you focus into this, this is also an odd electron molecule. Odd electron molecule. Now, if we draw the structures of ClO2 plus, it will look like this, with a lone pair plus here and two double bonds of oxygen. And this is sp2 hybridized. Similarly, this one will look like this. Here is a lone pair, here is another lone pair, and here is a double bond oxygen, here is another oxygen with a negative charge, and this will be somewhat sp3 hybridized. Okay, but this structure for ClO2 will be somewhere in between. That is, it will have a lone pair and a positive charge and one electron present here as odd electron and double bond oxygen O minus. And its hybridization will be is Pn, where n lies between 2 and 3. Right. So the structure of ClO2 should be intermediate between ClO2 plus and ClO2 minus. And since the electron count is intermediate, right, so hence we are getting the state of hybridization in chlorine of ClO2 will be intermediate to that of ClO2 plus and ClO2 minus. Now remember, as we have seen in the previous video for NO2, here also in monomeric ClO2, the odd electron is not fully localized over chlorine. Thus, the pairing of odd electron via the formation of chlorine-chlorine bond is not highly favored. Moreover, hypothetically, we can see a dimer formation, that is Cl2O4, formed via odd electron pairing. Then there will be some amount of lone pair repulsion and there will be a destabilization. So, VSEPR theory is inadequate to explain this odd electron to be localized over the chlorine. Now we will deal with the energetics of hybridization, which is most important part in this particular video, and we have to answer two questions, that is, explain why hydrogen-nitrogen-hydrogen bond angle in ammonia is 107.5 degree whereas for phosphine pH3-HPH bond angle is 90 degree, whereas for the second question is NH3 behaves as a stronger Lewis base than pH3. Now for the first question we will refer to the hybridization. And for the second question, we need to know the hybridization followed by the concept of basicity. Now, what do we mean by base? Base is something which can donate electrons. So, we have to consider the donation of electrons in this case. So, as we will see the hybridization, we will also get an explanation to it why ammonia is stronger Lewis base than pH3. So, let us first see the hybridization pattern. Now, first of all, if you try to see the structure, nitrogen is present here in between and we have three axes. Suppose this is a z axis, this is our y axis, this is our x axis, right? Now always remember, it is proposed that nitrogen is at the origin and the three hydrogen will approach the central nitrogen along the three coordinate axes. When they come at bonding distance, these three hydrogens suffer a repulsion. See this one, this hydrogen is coming from this direction, this hydrogen is coming from this direction, and this hydrogen is coming from this direction. So when they are close enough, when they come close enough, they will face a repulsion. As you can see here, they will face a repulsion. But in case of pH3, since its size is bigger, so this repulsion is reduced. So if we consider a P here, then hydrogens will come from here, hydrogen will come from here, and hydrogen will come from here. So the repulsion due to the increase in the size, okay, they can approach easily without any problem, because there is no repulsion since they are away from each other, right? So, in order to minimize this steric repulsion in ammonia, that is NH3, the system has to gain stability by losing energy. So, losing energy can be obtained by hybridization. Nitrogen undergoes hybridization to produce sp3 hybridized nitrogen. But in case of phosphorus, there is no need for hybridization to gain stability. So it can easily be like this and its bond angle is 90 degree. Whereas in this case, since there is a hybridization occurring, so the bond angle gets increased. So let us see the hybridization for ammonia. Now see here, for ammonia what happens? There is sp3 hybridization, whereas for phosphorus there is p3 hybridization. So for nitrogen, we have 2s and 2p, that is this one. There is a lone pair of electrons and there is 3 electrons. So right now we are concerned with sp3 hybridization. So this will form lone pair, this will form a sigma bond with hydrogen, this will form a sigma bond with hydrogen, and this will form a sigma bond with hydrogen. Ultimately, our ammonia will have sp3 hybridized orbitals, which will form this structure, and the bond angle will be 107.9 degree. Right, and for phosphorus, if we consider, phosphorus has 3s orbitals and 3p orbitals. Right, 3p. Now, these will form only hybridization, that is only p orbitals. So it will form p3 hybridization, and ultimately this will form a sigma bond with hydrogen, this will form a sigma bond with hydrogen, and this will form a sigma bond with hydrogen, and this will be the structure: phosphorus, hydrogen, 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 90 degree each. So to summarize, if we try to write the answer properly, in case of ammonia, it was proposed that the nitrogen is at the origin and the three hydrogen atoms approach the central nitrogen along the three coordinate axis. When they come at bonding distance, the three hydrogen suffers the steric repulsion due to the small size of nitrogen and the system gets energized. Now, in order to gain stabilization, what we need is that the bond angle that is present between this one, that is, if we see, the bond angle of hydrogen, nitrogen and hydrogen must increase, and this is only possible if we have sp3 hybridization of nitrogen. It is for this reason that this bond angle is close to tetrahedral bond angle, which is 107.5 degree due to the presence of lone pair, whereas during the formation of PH3, in the similar manner, the three hydrogen atoms approach at bonding distances and they will not suffer any steric repulsion due to larger size of phosphorus. The phosphorus will not undergo hybridization, and the PX, PY and PZ will directly undergo the formation of sigma bond. And so the nitrogen is suffering more repulsion, whereas the phosphorus is suffering the less repulsion, and the bond angle is close to 90 degree. So here we have seen sp3 hybridization, and here p3 hybridization can take place, but the more chance is that PX, PY and PZ directly bonds to the hydrogens, right? This hybridization may not take place because it can easily bind to the hydrogens. Now, this was the explanation for the first question. Now, if we try to answer the second question, now, according to the energetics of hybridization during the formation of ammonia, the central nitrogen has to undergo sp3 hybridization in order to minimize the steric repulsion, which we have seen. It is evident that lone pair is present in sp3 hybridized orbital, that is here, right? So it has a 25% s character, 25% s character. Now, how this occurs? If you see sp3, if you can understand this one, sp3 means that involvement of 4 orbitals. So s has a contribution of 1/4. So what will be the percentage now? 1/4 into 100 will be 25%. Whereas in the similar case for phosphorus, this is present in perfectly s orbital. That is 100% s character in this case. We have 100% s character for PH3. So greater the s character of orbital in which lone pair is present, greater will be the orbital electronegativity. As we have seen, if you have seen the acid base video, you can understand this, but if you have not watched it, you can watch it. I will give the link in the description box as well as the I button present above this video. So more the s character, more will be its electronegativity, and hence lesser will be the ability to donate the lone pair. It will be towards itself, and weaker will be the Lewis acid base. Weaker will be the Lewis basicity. Thus, PH3 will behave as weaker Lewis base than ammonia, since this particular has less S character, so it can be easily donated. So here ends the topic of hybridization. In the next video, we are going to deal with Benz rule. Hope this was helpful. And thank you for watching. Don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and comment.